This is session 7, create a project and start editing. Libraries store media and projects. Projects store edits. Media are the building blocks. Projects show how they're assembled. So in this movie, we're going to learn how to create and rename a new project. We'll explain basic project settings. We'll edit clips into the project using two powerful techniques. In fact, there are multiple ways we can edit clips into the timeline. This movie illustrates two. And then I'll show you how to play the timeline and move between clips. Compared to other editing software, Final Cut only allows one sequence per project. However, a library or event can store as many projects as you need. There's no limit to the number of clips that can be edited into a project, and media from multiple events and libraries can be edited into the same project. Plus, we now have project snapshots, which allow us to save a project at a particular moment in time. However, project snapshots are not locked. This means that if you make a change to a snapshot, that change is retained. I'll talk more about snapshots in a future movie. In the past, we would need to configure the project to match the technical parameters of the clip before editing started. Now, each project auto-configures itself based on the first clip that you edit into the timeline. Now, this is really helpful when dealing with multi-format projects. However, once a clip is in a project, many parameters can't be changed. The rule of thumb is to edit the first clip into the project that has the specs you want to use for your project. You can always remove this clip later when more clips are in the project. I call this locking the project. You edit a clip into the timeline. At that point, the image size, the codec, the frame rate are locked, and it can't be changed as you edit other formats of video in. Final Cut Pro 10 does not have tracks. It has layers. These are similar to layers inside Photoshop. Layers are not the same as tracks. In most cases, layers are more flexible, but tracks are more traditional. By default, video clips are 100% full screen and 100% opaque, which means video clips on higher layers block the clips below them. But this is not true of audio clips, where audio volume, not the layers the clips are on, determines what you hear and what you don't hear. We'll have more on this in Chapter 11. Couple definitions and then we're ready to shift gears. The first definition is primary storyline. Final Cut edits clips into or attached to storylines. The primary storyline, which is indicated by a darker gray channel, contains the main elements of your story. This is the default location where clips are edited. Other clips, such as music or titles, are connected to the primary storyline. There is only one primary storyline, and it can't be deleted. A connected clip is a single clip which is connected to a clip on the primary storyline. Move a primary storyline clip, and all clips connected to it move as well. A connected storyline, which we'll talk about later, is a collection of one or more clips which are gathered into a single entity called a storyline. Connected storylines are essential for adding transitions or trimming connected clips. Connections are always made to the primary storyline. Connections can be above or below the primary storyline, which, frankly, is just heresy. So let me show you how to create a new project and add it to an event. I'll explain the project settings window, show you how to rename and delete a project, edit clips to the project using append and connect, and show you how to play, stop, and move around the timeline using both the mouse and the keyboard. In this example, we're going to create a new project and edit some clips down to it, but I'm not going to worry too much about telling a story. I want to show you how the technique works. I'm going to select the glass blowing library, go up to File, select New, Project. Keyboard shortcut is Command N. We could also get there the same way by right mouse clicking on glass blowing and say New Project. This opens up the project settings dialog. Most of the time the defaults are fine, so we'll just say this is my new project. You can, of course, call it whatever you want. But this is important. You need to link it to an event. Now, you can use media from any event, from any library, but I want to make sure that I link it to the library that I'm going to use the media from the most, in this case, glass blowing. The reason is projects are stored in the event. And because I want to see where this project is when I go to that event, I want to make sure the project is stored in the right event. We haven't talked about timecode at all. Timecode is an address that uniquely identifies every frame of video. For right now, don't worry about it. We'll talk more about it in the future. This, though, is really important. What this does is, this allows you to set the timeline to match the video settings of the first clip you edit into the timeline. This is most often the best choice if you're shooting 1080i or 1080p, rather than have to worry about what the codec is and the frame rate and the scanning and the image size, and it just drives you nuts. Final Cut will take care of it. You just want to make sure that the first clip you edit is the format that you want. For people that care about matching specific criteria, though, click the Custom button, and you're able to specify whether you're editing 5K, 4K, 2K, standard def, what flavor of high def. You've got control over the image size and the frame rate. If the codec matches, great. If the codec doesn't match, Final Cut will automatically render, which means to calculate, will render a ProRes file based upon the video that's edited into your timeline, and you don't even have to worry about it. We're going to leave the audio and render properties alone at the default settings, which are perfectly okay for just about everybody. In this case, I'm going to set my video properties based upon the first clip, and I'm going to click OK. Several things happen at once. Inside the library, inside the event, there's glass blowing event, there's my new project. It shows the date that it was created. It shows how much time is in it. For instance, this one runs 1 minute, 11 seconds, and 14 frames. This one's got a blank screen because there's nothing in it. So that's how I create a new project. How would you rename a project? Highlight it. We're going to call this second project. Press the Enter key to record it. Renaming projects can be done at any time. My first project. Actually, it's my second project. So anyway, I could get carried away. Whoa, look at that. What happened? Projects are always displayed alphabetically. Well, that's not completely true. This gear menu has a lot to say about how clips and projects are sorted and grouped. We're going to save that for a later movie. For right now, I want to not have it be the first project, so I'm going to call it my second project. I'm going to leave it alone because we've made our point. The project that you want to open in a timeline, just click on it. You want to open this one, double-click it, it loads up into the timeline. Double-click the second one, it opens up into the timeline. You can move back and forth between projects, clicking this left or right pointing arrow. It allows you to move between projects that are stored in the same library. This is called the timeline history buttons. Look at that. All right, we're going to go down to here. Okay, let's find a clip. I'm going to just grab a nice cool clip here. Cool in relative terms, because boy, that looks awfully hot. We're going to edit that down to the timeline. Well, I could edit the entire clip, but most of the time we don't. Well, let's just type the letter I to set the in. Type the letter O to set the out. We can grab this and drag back and forth to change the clip that we want. We saw that on the movie on review. Now it's time to edit. There's two ways we can do this. Three ways. We could drag the clip down to the timeline, but if I ever catch you dragging, I'm just going to have to slap you because dragging is really slow, it's really inaccurate, and don't get in the habit of dragging. I don't want to have this lecture again. Dragging is bad. If all we want to do is edit this clip down to the timeline, you could click that button right there, and the clip shows up in the timeline. To play the clip, hit the spacebar. To stop playing, spacebar again. To go backwards, shift spacebar. Spacebar to stop, spacebar to play. There's a couple of very cool keys. If you type the letter L, that plays. K stops, J goes backwards. Type L twice, it's fast forward. K stops, J twice is back. Double speed. type L 3 times, type J 4 times, L 5 times, J 6 times. Suddenly you're going crazy in all directions. It's called the JKL keys. Works great to go high speed review, but here's something most people don't know. Hold the K and L key down at the same time, and we go slow motion forward. K and J at the same time, we go slow motion backward. Now that's cool. That impresses people at parties. But most of the time, my thumb's on the space bar, and it's just space bar to start and space bar to end. Okay, so far I've got a project that's exactly 1 clip long. Won't impress too many people. I need to add a second clip. So let's go to this glob thing here. Let's see, I to set an in, O to set an out, or we can grab this and drag it back and forth. This time, instead of clicking this button, I'm going to type the letter E as in edit, and it automatically appends that clip to the end of the timeline. In other editing software, we have to worry about where the playhead is. Notice the playhead was in the middle of that clip. How do I know? Do it again. Type the letter E. It doesn't make any difference where the playhead is. Whoa, look at that. Type the letter E. As fast as I type the letter E, the clip is appended to the end of all my clips. Now, yes, we can move clips around. That's the next movie. And we can edit at the position of the playhead. But if I taught you that, now you wouldn't come back and watch the other movies. How do we get rid of a clip? Well, we'll just Command-Z and undo that. We can also delete clips. That's also the next movie. Well, so what I have now is I have 2 clips in a timeline. If you type Shift-Z or Shift-Z, it expands the clips to fill the entire available timeline. Look at that. There's clip 1. See the yellow border? There's clip 2. And because it's the magnetic timeline, if I grab that clip and try and drag them apart, they snap back together again. Yes, there is a way to prevent that, but that's a future movie. Let's try something different. Let's go down to this little button here. Make the clip smaller and close this. I'm going to use the scroll wheel on my mouse to move up and down as necessary. I'm going to do a different kind of an edit. Let's find this fire edit here for reasons that make absolutely no sense. We'll just drag an in and out here. We've seen that when we do an append edit, the keyboard shortcut is the letter E. The button is this one right here. It edits a clip into the primary storyline. See that dark channel? But if I select this fire clip and click this edit right here, it does what's called a connected edit. It allows me to connect this clip to the primary storyline. See that little hooky thingy that's sticking in there? That's the connection. Drag that clip and notice the connected clip moves with it. So if I've got an interview who's talking down here and this is what they're talking about, if I decide to move that soundbite somewhere else in my project, all the clips, not just the B-roll, the image clips, but titles or sound effects or music, everything that's attached to that clip moves. We use this a lot when we're trying to hide a jump cut by having a B-roll clip. That's a clip that has pictures in it, bridge these 2 clips. So what we've seen is, oh, look at this, watch this. If I hit the home key, it goes to the beginning. The end key goes to the end. And I can see the people with laptops with their arms crossed and frowning saying, I don't have a home key or an end key. Hold down the FN key. And when you hold the FN key, type the left arrow. FN left arrow moves you home. FN right arrow moves you to the end. And if you use the up and down arrow keys, up arrow moves you back an edge of a clip at a time. Down arrow moves you forward an edge of a clip at a time. There's so much more we can do inside the timeline. We're going to be talking about it a lot. But the whole idea is you import your clips, you review your clips, you mark your clips, and you edit your clips. And once you get even reasonably good at it, the time between reviewing a clip and marking a clip and editing a clip is so fast because Final Cut just gets out of the way and lets you create that you do an I-O, type the letter E, and you're moving on to the next shot. Building a rough cut is as fast as you can think. One more thing before we start to edit. If you need to delete a project, right mouse click on it and say move it to trash. It isn't actually deleted, it's in the trash. If you need to recover it, you can. But if you need to delete a project, right mouse click and say move to trash. Editing projects in the timeline is where you'll spend almost all of your editing time. While there is tremendous editing power available to you, at its simplest, editing a clip to the timeline is as easy as set an in, set an out, and press a single key. Editing, in fact, is so fast that you never get distracted by the technology. Final Cut manages all the technical aspects so you can concentrate on telling your story. But when you need power tools, they're there, as Chapter 7 explains. This has been an excerpt of our most recent Final Cut Pro 10 training covering workflow and editing. For the complete version of this online training, please visit our store at larryjordan.biz/store. And thanks.